Some of them do. I don't know about the critics here.
Do you feel angry?
No, I don't. I play so many sounds, maybe it sounds angry because I'm trying so many things at one time, you see. Like, I haven't sorted them out. I have a whole bag of things that I'm trying to work through and get the one essential, you know. There are some set harmonic devices that I know that will take me out of the ordinary path, you see, if I use these. But I haven't played them enough, and I'm not familiar with them enough yet to take the one single line through them, so I play all of them.
Jazz classic, Wise World. John Coltrane Festival, here at radio station WKCR-FM, New York.
He was a dreamer, but he was a dreamer who dreamed imperial dreams. He was like Picasso. He went through a blue period in pointillism and in something else. And that's what John was doing musically, you know, experimenting and searching and skydiving with his parachute. And, you know, he was taking chances and just trying to see what he told somebody. He said, he approached some drummer and asked him, would he like to play with him? And then the drummer said, well, what are you doing? He says, I don't know what I'm doing. But he knew he wanted to do something. He was trying to find out by doing this and this and this to try to arrive at what he felt. It was so new that he didn't even know himself what it was. And that's when he developed these ribbons of sound. These ideas were like ribbon streamers going across landscapes.
Coltrane drove himself relentlessly, both physically and musically. It was all or nothing. He really was on a quest, a journey of discovery with no boundaries. And there's a story for me that really sums this up. Between sets in San Francisco, he would reputedly leave the venue, walk 10 or 12 blocks with a pair of binoculars, and gaze at the night stars. In every waking moment, he was looking for inspiration.
He would practice during the day, play at night, play during intermission in the kitchen or the men's room, go home and play at night, fall asleep in the bed with the horn on his chest, you know. Practice like a man with no talent, and he had all the talent in the world. Playing like that, it'll set him aside from everybody else.
Musician describing to me how after a performance he went up to his house uptown to see him. He opened the door and John was lying on the bed asleep with the saxophone on his stomach. He just practiced himself to sleep.
I've come to meet pianist McCoy Tyner. He was just 21 when Coltrane stole him from Benny Golson's band. Coltrane was now putting together a new quartet, and McCoy was expecting to be stretched by Coltrane's new sounds.
He did do certain kind of versions, like My Favorite Things, obviously, is mm-hmm. one of those
yes.
pieces. But it yes. was rare that he tackled anything which might have a kind of a popular idiom, wasn't it?
Yeah, what he realized is that maybe it's nothing wrong with doing My Favorite Things. Actually, when it was brought to my attention, I asked him, I said, you want to do that? Or, I had heard it, but, I never thought we'd do it. But
it worked.
Yeah, nice. And then we did Chim Chim Cheree, we did that, you know. But he never sacrificed in terms of what he wanted to do with those songs. It was never a compromise kind of thing, you know. He always threw it, you know, it's just it's just a wonderful way to express yourself. I'm so happy that I had the opportunity to play with him because he was my teacher.
By the early 1960s, Coltrane had assembled his classic quartet. Tyner on piano, Jimmy Garrison on bass, Elvin Jones on drums. They hit the road with Coltrane's trademark passion and drive. There were endless rounds of touring. Coltrane was terrified of flying, so the band would cram themselves into a van and drive coast to coast across America for 6 weeks solid. And then a 6 week stint in New York. Life on the road was exhausting, so Coltrane fell back on one of his lifelong passions, eating. Food was a comfort thing for him. It was even reported that he ate so many mint humbugs, his sax keys became clogged up with sugar.
When he would come home from the road, you know, he would tell her mother, "Aunt Betty, I want 100 rolls." And then she tried to make him 100 rolls or something. And he liked to eat.
We used to look for places that served brains and eggs. I don't know if you've ever heard of it. The brains from a hog. You get those brains and you saute it with onions and with eggs. And we loved it. Both of us did. And I don't know if you know what hominy grits are. Grits, the people call it. Grits and gravy and biscuits. And we'd look for a restaurant serving that, and we found it. As long as we were there, that's where we were every morning, having brains and eggs, grits with gravy and biscuits.
Years on, it isn't easy to retrace Coltrane's footsteps in a constantly changing New York. I went to look for one of the venues most associated with the Coltrane legend. It's now become, appropriately enough, a deli.
Classic, my favorite things, near 2:30, the John Coltrane Festival, here at radio station WKCR-FM.
This was the Half Note, the most famous jazz club in New York. And in the 60s, Coltrane more or less invented the avant-garde here. The stage was up there, and it was incredibly cramped. They used to perform literally standing on the bar. You can't even see where McCoy is, the pianist. He's stuck there in the back. There's a great shot of Coltrane, slightly overweight as he was in the last years. Coltrane was only in his mid-30s, but already he'd become a kind of guru of the jazz avant-garde. There was now virtually a school of Coltrane and a host of eager young acolytes.
He was surrounded constantly by people like Pharoah Sanders, Wayne Shorter. They were all there. John was a Buddha, and we were his disciples. People took advantage of him, and they took advantage of his humility and his generosity. He never spoke about himself, actually, except when he talked about the musical problems that he might be having. And then he was quite honest, and he almost made the person he was talking to feel as though they were equal to him in expertise. There was a lot of musical sense to what he was doing, because he saw that in the Negro spiritual we had the basic African pentatonic scale.